obviously it takes a lot of time if you want enough data to train against. And with these sorts of networks, or these sorts of classifiers, you typically do need like a lot of data, like somewhere around 100 data points to get like actually like a solid, accurate reading. And we just basically don't have the time to do that if we're trying to actually iterate the design.
So now that we have both the hardware and software, how do we actually put them together and make it run? And that's what the part is going to talk about.
Well, actually, before we talk about that, let's just get back to a quick demo of this in action. So you can see here, this is basically what our robot is all over there. And this is basically what our robot is seeing. So you can see this is the camera image after it's after all the pre-processing has been applied. So you can see where it detects letters, and then it shows on screen what the letter actually is. So in some cases, you'll see like off in the distance, and there's like faint letters. But it doesn't detect them. And that's on purpose because with our robot, when it's navigating the maze, we only really care about what's right next to it. So again, this is where that size restriction comes back into play, because basically based on the size, we can reject anything that we don't actually care about right now. So yeah, you can see sometimes in the map, there's what looks like a letter, but our algorithm just ignores it, which basically makes our robot a lot more efficient because it doesn't have to filter out and deal with, hey, is this a letter? Is it actually big enough? Is it close enough that I actually need to worry about it? And so next, let's actually go back to how to deploy this. So yeah, again, we have all of this software, but now we need to get it to run on our hardware. So then this poses its own set of challenges. So, with software, all software has dependencies, which is problem number one. So first of all, our software in this case depends on OpenCV, which is a computer vision library to obviously do all of our computer vision tasks, and also ROS, which is called the operating system. And so all of our software needs these dependencies in order to run. But we need to get these dependencies onto our target system. So this is where the second problem comes in. Some dependencies require compiling. So this is turning like source code into machine code for the robot, for the hardware to actually run. So both of the dependencies I talked about, OpenCV and ROS, both have compiled components. And one part of the issue we have here is that compiling these can actually take quite a long time. So for instance, on this Pi Zero we have here on this robot, you can't really see it that well, but it's on there, I promise. It takes about somewhere around 8 hours to compile OpenCV. And then we haven't even tried compiling ROS. So as you can see, the compile time can actually be an issue when it comes to getting these deployed. So one way to solve this is cross-compiling, which is basically compiling from one machine to target a different machine. So both of these, the microprocessors run something called ARM. So it's a different instruction set than the normal x86 that you find in your computers, like for the Core i5 or anything. So they're not compatible, but there are ways to set up tool chains, which are basically compiler infrastructure. So you can compile from one to the other. But setting these up is usually very complicated. It involves like recreating whole system library path. It's not always easy to make it work properly. And next, we also have the point that compiling on the device is slow as it runs. So this brings up another problem, which is that because compiling and making these dependencies is so time consuming, oftentimes we don't actually keep the versions up to date if we just have it installed on. So for instance, with our Pi Zero over here, because it took a full 8 hours to compile it, we never updated our software since I think 4 years ago when we first set it up. So naturally, that has its own set of issues, such as so our OpenCV version was obviously quite out of date by now, which caused some interesting issues when it came to running our actual code, because when we're developing on our machines, like our laptops, we have actually up-to-date version, but that's not the same version we're running on here. So then that can quickly create headaches between us not realizing that something has changed or and not being very obvious where the problem is. Like, it works in my machine, why doesn't it work here? So to solve all of these issues, we used a container system. So containerization is, or at least as of a year or two ago, was a very popular topic in the cloud computing industry. But instead of running it in the cloud, we decided to bring it to the world of robotics. So first of all, what is a container? What's Docker that we're talking about here? So a container is basically a way to run software and package all of its dependencies together so that we can easily move it between systems and have it run reliably. So as you can see, this is designed to solve one of our main issues, the dependency management. And so, as you can see here, in the Docker container, we can put all of our dependencies. So in this case, Docker actually contains the entire Linux system, a small Linux system image that it runs off. So basically, inside of the container, we have all of the files that the program needs to run. So think of it just as a lightweight virtual machine. So another advantage is, again, that we can easily move these from one place to another. So one of the main appeals of Docker is that if we can run Docker on these two systems, we can pretty much guarantee that this container will run the same way on these two systems. So this way, we can have reproducible builds. And we can also make sure that our program is in a known state. I don't want to say known good state because you can always have issues with your program, but at least with the Docker container, even if it's in a known bad state, it's going to be consistently in a bad state, not sometimes working and sometimes not. And the containers also bring more benefits to our workflow. So as I said, they contain the full file system, which means this actually makes cross-building basically a non-issue. Since we have basically the full system, there's technology called QEMU, which is basically an emulator, which allows us to actually run these ARM executables. So the entire virtual system that's running inside the container on x86 without any issues. So this allows us to test our containers very easily because, again, the containers are reliable, as in they will have the same results where we can run it. And so now, because we have QEMU, we can add our laptops and x86 systems to the list of places where we can run this. So we can know for sure, know ahead of time exactly what our code is going to do without actually having to put it onto physical hardware. And again, because we can run x86, we can run ARM on x86, that means we can also build on x86 because the compilers are just more blobs of ARM, so we can run those on x86 as well. So that means instead of building on the hardware and locking up our hardware for a couple hours as it compiles something, we can also build it on just normal computers like our laptop. However, no one wants their laptop churning away for a couple hours building something, so the next step is to move it to the cloud. So we can also set up a workflow so that all of our containers are actually built on cloud service. So we're using GitLab, which is a code hosting service, which also provides continuous integration so that whenever we make changes to our code base, it will automatically build these Docker images for us in the cloud so that we don't even have to worry about our machines being busy. Because just after we push the code, then we can pull down the built image and then put it on our system to run. This way, we can streamline our whole development workflow, or our whole deployment workflow from start to finish. So, in conclusion, all of the work we have done allows us to have a system that runs with very low physical space and also processing ability capabilities, and still do fast real-time analysis of these letters at a consistent 30 FPS, which in our case is particularly important too because our robot's moving. We need to be able to keep up with the robot moving. So by building a system that's able to keep up with that robot, we don't have to handicap our robot just to get our vision system. And also with our algorithms that we created is accurate and adaptable to changing conditions and even slightly different letter shapes. And also we have a clean, simple, well, not necessarily simple, but straightforward and reproducible deployment flow to get our code from our computer and onto the physical robot and running correctly. That's it from us. Do you have any questions? Yes? Sorry, I can't hear you. Can you speak up? We can't hear you.
Interested in your K nearest neighbor algorithm. Is that something that you came up with, and where can I get more information on that?
It's actually a very common algorithm that, it's a sort of machine learning algorithm that's pretty common, and we didn't come up with it, obviously, because it's been around for a while, but it just basically just takes training data and associates a new point with all the training data by just simply grabbing all the values of the data.
So you've had training data on items that say like 5 attributes. You have space data that's numbers.
Right.
That's how you determine something that fits into that class. Is that how?
So, yeah, basically we can define the different classes of objects we want to classify things into, and it, based on, you know, the distance in dimensional space, it basically lets it calculate which class it belongs to more. If you want more information, there's plenty of articles on the internet. For instance, this diagram we took off of Wikipedia.
Thanks.
I thought it was very clever that you used containers. What was the build? What was the cloud that you used to build it? To build the software?
So we used GitLab's continuous integration infrastructure, which I believe runs on DigitalOcean, but it really doesn't matter because we don't need to worry about it. So we just set up like our workflow to say build this, and then they handle it in cloud for us. Anyone else?
Thank you everyone for coming. We're also in zone 3.
Zone 1.
Sorry, zone 1.